that time. All right, so with that, let's get into our scriptures, as I said, and open your Bibles, if you can, to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 16 will be our scripture portion for today. Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 16. And can I request Yunoya to come and read for us verses 1 to 16, please?
That's exactly what I was waiting for.
Okay. Thank you.
1 through 16, right?
Yep.
Of 5 or 4?
5.
Okay. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is henceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify the Father which is in heaven.
Yeah, thank you, darling.
I already memorized most of that.
Yeah, okay, good. All right, thank you, sweetheart. And actually, you know what? It was a good thing that you were waiting for reading the scripture portion, because looking at your face, I realized that we need to first read the scriptures, and Yunoya has to read the scriptures. That was a prompting. All right, so thank you for that prompting. Now, when Yunoya was reading the scripture portion, okay, I was sitting there, and I was not thinking about that earlier, but when she started reading, especially from verses 3 to 5, it says, Blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are they that mourn, blessed are they that are meek. What? I was thinking, is God blessing the people who are losers? Right? I mean, like, from the worldly perspective, these are the people who are losers. Why should God be blessing the losers instead of God blessing those who are victorious, right? We are supposed to be victorious, and God is saying that all the losers will be blessed. Is that the understanding we should be getting? Absolutely not, right? So we'll see what exactly we can understand from this scripture portion, which is, in other words, referred to also as Beatitudes. Do you know what Beatitudes means? What does it mean?
It means God's blessings, right?
Uh-huh.
And
okay, so let me break it up for you. Beatitudes is a word which is a combination of two words.
What your attitude should be.
So it is not really a word in English dictionary,
yeah,
but it has become so popular because this is talking about the attitude that we should be not having. Okay, it is not have attitudes, it is be attitudes. Okay, meaning, in other words, this is the attitude we should not just have, but this is the attitude which we should be. It should become a personality. It should become our personality, our nature, right? That is what the Bible says, that is what the theologians and scholars have meant, and that is the reason why they talk about this section of the scripture portion as Beatitudes, okay? Now, there was a Christian school, okay, similar to what Yunoya goes to, a Christian school, and during the lunch hour, all the kids were standing in a line to get their food. And at the end of the table, there was there were some apples in a basket, and there was a sign which said, "Take only one. God is watching." It's a Christian school, so they wanted to put the fear of God all the time, and they always refer to God, unlike a secular school, right, in the United States. So they said, "Take only one. God is watching." And I think this is important because parents might not be watching, teachers might not be watching, but if we have the fear of God and if we know that God is watching, we'll be careful. So they put that sign, take only one, God is watching. And along the table, there was also one basket wherein there were chocolate chip cookies. So a kid saw that. And he was a mischievous kid, so he made up a sign of his own and put it there in that cookie basket. And it said, "Take all you want. God is watching the apples." Okay, God is not watching the cookies. God is watching the apples. So take all you want. definitely that was not the meaning which was conveyed when the apples basket had that sign, take only one, God is watching. Doesn't mean that you can take as many as you want of the cookies. But yeah, children truly want as many cookies as they like to eat, and they don't want any limitations or restrictions on that. But anyway, when we are talking about, even in this context, when we say God is watching, He's not watching just our actions. Whether you take one apple or not, that is not what is of interest to God. What is your heart as far as taking that apple is concerned? Would you get greedy? Would you get deceptive? Would you take one and hide it? So it is about the heart, not your actions, isn't it? So it is the attitude that God will be watching, not the actions, right? Because attitudes generally lead to actions. And therefore, today we will consider what attitudes we should be having, right? But I'm calling the title of my sermon as Saved Heart. Okay, it is talking about the heart, what kind of a heart a saved person should have. Now, I'm very grateful to God that this is a Christian home. And I'm particularly grateful to God that He not only gave me and my wife Sandhya salvation, but He has given salvation to even Yunoya, right? So I'm very grateful to God because a saved heart will have benefits not just in heaven, but will have benefits here on earth also if we have the right attitude. I mean, you can be saved, but in addition to that, we need to grow in our walk with God. And we should grow in word and spirit so that we can not just have a better conduct, but also have a transformation of heart and continually grow into the image of Jesus Christ. So we'll be talking about the saved heart, what kind of a heart a saved person should be having. And we'll be talking about five attributes or five attitudes that we should be having. Okay, Beatitudes, five attitudes we'll be looking at. And those five I'm talking about I'm referring to as sensitive heart. Your heart should be sensitive. You should not smear your heart towards sin. You should be sensitive towards sin. Secondly, we should have a spiritual heart. All your thinking should be always in terms of spiritual dimensions. So we should have a spiritual heart. Third, we should have a servant heart. Okay, now, it's easy for us to have a desire to be the boss, but not a servant. It is very difficult for a human being, okay, to not, it's very easy for us not to desire higher position and higher status. But is that what we are talking about as far as our heart is concerned when we say servant heart? Is that what we should be understanding or no? We'll consider that. And fourth, kind of heart we should be having is a savory heart. What does savory means? Okay, it should be something which is tasty, right? Savory. So we should have a heart which is savory, meaning other people should be pleased by it. They should savor and they should relish the heart which we have. And finally, we should have a stirring heart. Stirring heart. What is stirring heart? How do we understand? What does stirring mean? Daddy is driving his car. What does he do?
He turns the wheel.
So when I'm turning the wheel, what I'm doing? I'm steering the vehicle into one direction or the other direction. So a Christian has a responsibility of steering, not himself or alone. He should steer himself in the right path, but not just himself. He has the responsibility, or she has the responsibility, to steer other people also in the right direction. So we'll be talking about these five attitudes or five hearts or five attributes of a heart, which are sensitive heart, spiritual heart, servant heart, savory heart, and steering heart. All right. So with that, let's get into our scripture portion. And what we see actually in verses 1 and 2 is a context. Right? The real attitudes we'll be looking at will be from verse 3 onwards, but the context here is also very important. And what does the Bible say as far as context is concerned? The first two verses it says, and seeing the multitude. Okay, so from this itself we can understand at this point Jesus had a huge following, huge gathering. Right? So he saw the multitude and he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. Okay, so the whole multitude which was following Jesus, they were all his disciples. Because they were all his followers. They were trying to learn from him. They were trying to conduct themselves according to what teachings they hear from him. Right? And in verse 2 it says, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying. So he already became a teacher, not just for a small 12 people group. He was not teaching only to the apostles at this time. He was teaching to multitudes already. And last week, when we considered progression, we understood that Jesus not just called disciples at this time, but he also performed a miracle, the first miracle in Cana. And he was also healing people, and he was also baptizing people. And when he was baptizing multitudes, he was baptizing more people, though he did not himself baptize, but his disciples were baptizing. So he already became popular in that aspect. Not just that, even a person like Nicodemus, he came to Jesus to learn from Jesus, how to enter into the kingdom of God. And so Jesus gave him that clarification, and he clarified that we should be born of the Spirit, not just of physical birth, right? So the context here is there was a multitude which was following Jesus at this point in time. Jesus already had a huge following, which were disciples. And verse 3 onwards is where we actually see the attributes I was talking about. And let's start with the sensitive heart. The first kind of a heart I was talking about is a sensitive heart. And it starts off as, blessed are the poor in spirit. Who are poor in spirit? That is the first question we need to understand. Right? Because, I've heard a person talking about, a preacher, he preaches in a bigger context. And, he was a preacher who had some ministry. And that person, he was saying, when we grow in spirit, when a Christian is born, he is a baby in Christ, but gradually he keeps growing and growing. That's how he becomes matured. And that is when he will not be poor in spirit. Is that what we need to understand? No. Because God is saying, blessed are the poor in spirit. So is God saying that a person who did not grow in word and spirit is the one who is more blessed than the person who grew in the word of God? Absolutely not, right? So what this says actually is that a person who is poor in spirit, who is not prideful. Okay, because what does the Bible say? Pride goes before the fall, right? So a prideful person will fall. Why did Satan become Satan? It is because of pride. Satan was a very powerful angel. And in fact, the Bible talks about Satan as the angel of light. Right? So from that glory, Satan fell because Satan had pride. Right? So what it says here is, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Okay, only a person who is contrite, who is not prideful and boastful, only such person will enter into the kingdom of heaven. That is the reason why the Bible says, be converted like a child. Okay, you will see less pride in a child. I mean, children are not sinful, but they are not prideful either, because they depend, they have faith in their parents. Right? And verse 4 says, blessed are they that mourn. Why would people mourn? They will mourn when they recognize that they are sinful people. Okay, let your laughter become mourning. Why would God want laughter to become mourning? Let your happiness become mourning. Let your joy become mourning. Why would God want us to be mournful? Because we should not be boastful about our sin. There are many people who are boastful about their sin. In fact, the United States is the best example where people are boastful about their sinfulness, and Hollywood probably is the best place where you can see, best in the sense, the worst kind of, I mean, like, you know, boasting they have, or like, you know, when it comes to glorifying sin, we see that from Hollywood. Not just that, the whole society is moving towards that, because I would say probably the political leaders are also driving this country in that direction, wherein people are boastful about their sin and not mourning about their sin, for they shall be comforted. If you are mourning about your sin, then you will be comforted. And verse 5 says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit earth. What does meek mean?
Gentle.
What else?
Humble.
Humble, yes. That is the word which I was looking for. Okay, a person is meek, especially when a person is sinning and God is rebuking that person. The person is meek. He's accepting that rebuke. Such are the people that God will be blessing. So here we can see, in all these three cases, a person has to be sensitive towards what? Sensitive towards personal sin. Okay, we should not smear our conscience, but we should be sensitive when we are sinning. Okay, we should repent of it. We should be contrite, poor in spirit. And when we are sinful, okay, we should mourn about it, not boast about it. And when we are sinful, we should be meek about it. God may be punishing us, God may be correcting us, God may be admonishing us. We need to take that admonishment with humility and humbleness. That is when we will be blessed. That is what essentially we are saying. We are not talking about losers, as the world talks about. But we are talking about, in order for us to be victorious, we should have sensitivity towards sin, and we should have a sensitive heart. Right? And that is the reason why we read in Psalm chapter 34 verses 17 to 20, wherein we see what a contrite spirit, or how a contrite spirit should be displayed, and why God will reward such people. Right? Psalm chapter 34 verses 17 to 20, it reads as follows. The righteous cry, and the Lord heareth, and delivereth them out of all their troubles. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of broken hearted. If you have a broken heart, if you are repenting, that's when you have a broken heart. And when you have a broken heart, God will be near them, and saveth such as be of contrite spirit. Okay, so a heart can be broken for many reasons. Okay, a boy falls in love, a girl falls in love, and the other person doesn't respond, or the other person breaks up the relationship, a heart could be broken. My heart breaks all the time when my wife is... Okay, but there could be reasons why hearts are broken. But we're not talking about that, because here the Bible says, contrite spirit, and saveth such as be of contrite spirit. Okay, contrition, when we sin, we have to repent of it. That is when God will be nigh unto such people and save such people. Verse 19 says, many are the afflictions of the righteous. Righteous people should not expect not to be afflicted. Many are the righteous, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. we will be delivered from every of our trouble, every of our affliction, if we have that kind of a contrite spirit. He keepeth all his bones, not one of them is broken. In fact, when we talk about this, he keepeth all his bones, this is actually a prophecy also about Jesus Christ. That is the reason why Jesus, when he was on the cross, none of his bones were broken, not one of his bone was broken. His body was broken, but his bones were not broken. Right? So this is becoming a fulfillment of a prophecy. But in addition to that, when you consider in this context also, whatever losses we have, like whatever afflictions we have, he will deliver us, and any loss that we are suffering ultimately will be made up, because we'll be rewarded in heaven, or we'll be rewarded with heaven and in heaven. So from that we can understand God saves the contrite spirit, and that is what we are talking about. We are not talking about the losers who are foolish on this earth, and because of that they might enter into a lot of suffering. No, we are not talking about such people. We are talking about people who, when they have sinned, they have become contrite. Right? And that is another reason why we read in James chapter 4 verses 6 and 7. James chapter 4 verses 6 and 7. How can we become contrite is what we are understanding here. Because sorrow, say for example, when you consider Judas Iscariot. Okay, he was sorry for what he did, but he went and died. So sorrow, physical sorrow, bodily sorrow, worldly sorrow leads to death. But godly sorrow alone will lead to righteousness and will lead to salvation. Right? So that is what we see here. In verse 6 it says, but he giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Okay, we should humble ourselves when we are sinful. In verse 7, submit yourself therefore to God. If you submit yourself, that is when you are truly exhibiting your contriteness and you are exhibiting your humility. And finally it says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. So if you are submitting to God, Satan will not have power over you, because you are now God's servant, isn't it? So with that, let's move to the next thought which I wanted to present today about the Beatitudes, or about the saved heart. And the second attribute is spiritual heart. We should have a spiritual heart. What does it mean? Let's start reading the scriptures, and then from the scriptures we'll understand. It says, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. What is righteousness? The desire to always do good, right? But there is a problem with thinking that we should always do good by our own capacity, because what does the Bible say? Our righteousness is like filthy rags. So it's not talking about just having a desire to do good. That is important, that is required. But more important than that is, we should be righteous because of God's forgiveness and because of the imputed righteousness we have from God. Okay, so the righteousness we are talking about here, those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, is the godly righteousness, God righteousness, God-given righteousness to us, for they shall be filled. If you have that kind of a righteousness, you will have more satisfaction than self-righteousness. Okay, say for example, you do good to someone, and that person in return does harm to you, hurt to you. How do you feel? You feel dejected. I should never do such a good thing to anyone again, to these ungrateful people. That way we'll become resentful of the good we are doing, right? So when we do righteousness, when we do self-righteous deeds, that is when we can repent about the good we have done. But if we have God's righteousness in us, when we do good to other people and when they hurt, we recognize that could become a blessing for us as well. Right? So that is the kind of righteousness we are talking. We are talking about the spiritual righteousness, godly righteousness. And verse 7 says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Okay, so why should we be merciful in order to obtain mercy, or why should we be forgiving people in order to receive forgiveness? That is also very important for us to understand. Because, like, probably the best way for us to understand is to read the parable which Jesus has given to his disciples. This parable is in Matthew chapter 18, verses 32 to 35. Matthew chapter 18. Verses 32 to 35. Probably this story is very familiar to each one of us. This parable is very familiar to each one of us, wherein a servant owed the king certain amount of money. Okay, because that person was not able to pay back that money, he pleaded with the king, and the king forgave him, and he forgave the debt also. But the same person had another servant, co-servant, who owed something to this person, small money, far less when compared to what he was forgiven. And that person did not forgive that other servant. And from that, what we can understand is, when you consider the amount of forgiveness we have received from God, we are wicked. Our hearts are wicked. The Bible says the heart is the most deceitful, and it is utterly wicked, and our minds are continually evil. That is what a human state is. But in spite of that, God has forgiven us, every one of us who have received his salvation. He has forgiven us that kind of unrighteousness. When we have received that kind of unrighteousness, and when we compare to the unrighteousness or any sin people commit against us, that is far less from what we have been forgiven. Is it not? So let's quickly read, because the story itself is so self-explanatory. It says in verse 32 to 35, Matthew chapter 18, verses 32 to 35. Then his Lord, after that he had called him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all the debt because thou desirest me. Shouldest not thou also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? And his Lord was wroth, and delivered him to the tormentors, till he should pay all that was due unto him. Okay, so we don't want to pay for our sins, and we don't want God to get angry. Therefore, we should show mercy to other people. Verse 35. So likewise, shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if ye from your hearts forgive not every one his brother their trespasses. Okay, so we should forgive everyone their trespasses. That's what we understand, right? So blessed are they which hunger and thirst after righteousness. It's only possible if we are spiritual. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. There again, we should have a spiritual consideration. We should consider our salvation, and based on that, God is expecting us to show mercy to other people. And verse 8 says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. How can we be pure in heart? It is again by forgiveness of God. Because when we say, if we say we do not have sin in us, we do not have truth in us. But if we confess our sins, then God is faithful and just to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we have to become holy. We have to become pure. How do we become pure? Only by God's imputed righteousness. Okay, therefore we can clearly understand here that we should be having a spiritual heart. So we should be having a spiritual heart. Right? So we should hunger and thirst after righteousness. We should be merciful, and we should be pure also. Alright, so with that, let's move on to the third attribute of the heart a Christian heart should be, or Christian heart should have, which is servant's heart. Alright, we should have a servant heart. What does servant heart mean? Mommy, get me water. But when mommy says, you know, better, could you get me some water? No, go get it yourself. That is not what it is, right? Clearly. Right? So anyway, but here, the more important aspect of servanthood we are talking about is not just our physical servanthood. Okay, it is more in terms of spiritual things. So let me tell you why I say so. And we'll be reading from verses 9 to 12, wherein it says, blessed are the peacemakers. Okay, how do you make peace? By serving God. How can people, how can you be a peacemaker? Like say for example, if two people are fighting, you reconcile them, right? That is peacemaking. But more important than that is, if you can help people to have peace with God, that is the greatest peacemaking. And such people, I would say, are most blessed. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. And this is very important for us, because when you consider God's perspective about peacemaking, when Jesus came onto this earth, he did not stop all the wars on this earth, right? But he was a peacemaker also, because he was reconciling man with God. That is the peacemaking which we are referring to here. And in order for us to make that peace, okay, how can we do that? By proclaiming the gospel. Now, everyone might not become a preacher or teacher, but everyone has the responsibility of being a witness, testifying to God, right? So you shall be my witnesses where? In Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and uttermost parts of the earth. Okay, so that is how we can truly make the peace. That is how we can truly be peacemakers, and that is when we truly will be blessed. So, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. So, in other words, we should be children, we'll become children of God when we serve God, when we proclaim his gospel, when we testify for him. So that is the peacemaking we are talking about here. And that is the reason why in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 20, Paul talking about himself, he says, now then we are ambassadors for Christ. He was talking about he and his ministry group or his missionary team. And today, we also, if we are serving God, then we can say the same thing. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God, what is God doing? God, as though God did beseech you by us. God is talking to you through us. We are the messengers. We are the mouthpieces. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead be reconciled to God. That is the peacemaking we are talking about, right? I know those are distracting you a lot, but pay attention here. They will not hurt you. All right. So that is what we are talking about when we are saying we should have a servant heart. We should be willing to serve God, not giving water to mommy. I mean, giving water to mommy is important, but more important than that is serving God in proclaiming the gospel, in advancing the gospel, right? And in verse 10, it says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness. Again, look at this, right? So if you are serving God and that's when you are suffering persecution, that is when you are blessed. That is the reason why it says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Verse 11, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. It's all about God. Okay, it is not like when, say for example, because you have done something wrong and you are punished. Maybe you have defrauded someone and because of that you went to jail. That is not persecution and you will not be blessed for such things. But instead, if you suffer for Christ, for his name's sake, for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And verse 12 says, rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Okay, so when you serve God, you're blessed. When you're persecuted because you're serving God, you're blessed. So anything you do for God is when you're serving God, that is when you're blessed. And therefore, we need to have a Christian heart should be a servant heart, right? And with that, let's move on to the fourth heart which I was talking about, or fourth attribute of a heart, a Christian heart or a saved heart, which is savory heart. People should be pleased when they are around us. Okay, and it says in verse 13, in verse 13 is where we see that. It says, ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt lost its savor, Okay, when people talk about salt, don't get into all the chemistry about salt. I've heard people talk about salt is NaCl, okay, sodium chloride, and it reacts with acids like this, it reacts with bases like that. That is not what the Bible is talking about here. In its context, when you read, it says, ye are the salt of the earth, but if salt have lost its savor. So savor is what we are talking about when we are talking about saltiness. In other words, we should be tasty, right? Tasty in the sense we are not expecting people to eat us. Okay, so don't expect that daddy will eat you better. But what it says here is, ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its savor. In other words, if your actions are causing someone to be unhappy and displeased, dejected, okay, that is when we are losing our savor. Wherewith shall it be salted again? Okay, it is henceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under the foot of man. Okay, if salt is lost its savor, I mean, we don't do that here in the United States, like, you know, we don't throw the trash on the streets, but especially in that context, in the Judean region, if a salt lost its savor, it would be thrown on the street so that it will keep down the dust. And when it is thrown on the streets, people walk on it, trample on it. So it was a literal scenario or situation you see on a daily, in a daily life. And that is how a Christian, if he's not being a Christian, will be treated by the world. That is the reason many a times, like, you know, when people say, I'm a Christian, first thing they talk about when they see something not good in you, you claim to be a Christian and this is how you're doing. Okay, this is not how you ought to be. Even the outsiders point out and say, hey, this is not becoming of you as a Christian. So we have to have good conduct so that we can be pleasing to people. And also, when we are pleasing to people, it gives a good witness so that people will get drawn to Jesus Christ. That is the reason why the Bible says, okay, in fact, we see that in the next verse itself, so let me reserve to that. But on the whole, because of our good deeds, people should get attracted to God. So that should be the savoriness of our hearts. With that, finally, let's get into the final attribute of our heart, which should be the attitude, and that is steering heart. We should guide ourselves in the right path, but not just that, we should be guiding other people also into the right path, not letting them to go astray. And we see that in verses 15 to 16, wherein it says, ye are the light of the world. Okay, a city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Now this is very important. Right? So the Bible says a city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Can you ever hide light? No, you cannot, if it is there on the hill. That is how a Christian will be noticeable. Whether we do good or bad, we will be noticeable. Right? So because we are always noticeable, it is a better thing for us to do the good so that we'll be noticed for the right reasons. And verse 15 says, neither do men light a candle and put it under the bushel, but on a candlestick. And it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Okay, so I think this is something which I've explained in the past also. But consider this. Okay, someone lights a candle and then puts a bushel on, put it under a bushel. Meaning bushel is nothing but a vessel. You put it under a bushel. What is the purpose of a candle? It is to give light to light in the home. But you are shedding off that light. How foolish that would be. How wasteful that would be. Right? That is how a Christian life will be. If we are not showing light to the other people, what does it mean to show light to the other people? Verse 16. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Okay, people should see your good works. Your good works are the light. If we have good works, then people will see the good works in us and then they will glorify the Father. Okay, so in other words, it is because of us God gets glorified, or through our actions, through our good deeds, God gets glorified. Now, generally, when people glorify God, okay, their God is great. When people say, Sajjan's God is great, Vinaya's God is great, Sandhya's God is great, what are they admitting? They're admitting that this is the Almighty God, Omniscient God, and that is how people will want to submit to that God, people will want to surrender to that God. Right? So that is how we should conduct ourselves. So the five attributes of a Christian heart or a saved heart should be sensitive heart, spiritual heart, servant heart, savory heart, and steering heart. May God help us to have these attitudes, so that we might glorify God and we might draw many to Him. Let us close with a word of prayer. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, once again for this wonderful privilege you have given to us. Lord, it is by your grace that we are saved through faith. Nevertheless, Lord, while we live on this earth, you expect us to have good works, not so that we get saved, because, Lord, we recognize that our righteousness is like filthy rags. Nevertheless, Lord, because of our good works, you would want us to use for your glory through our good works. And Lord, knowing the great salvation you have given to us, help us to submit ourselves, surrender ourselves, and humble ourselves and walk according to your will. And may we have the right attitudes, may we have the right attributes as Christians. And Lord, may we not repel those who do not know you from you, but rather help us to attract people towards you because of our good works. May we have that attitudes, may we have that behavior, may we be those attitudes. I pray for your anointing upon each one of us so that, Lord, we might be those attitudes and glorify your name. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.